how come Park and Rec just gets to spend $60,000 of the town's money to give the church what they want?
I don't think the total's there, but that change order has a deduct, I don't know exactly, I can't remember the deduct, but I hope the church wants a bigger one, they're gonna kick in some.
I suspect they'll be up to tell us about it.
We are open. Okay, so I would like to open the Georgetown Planning Board August 3rd, 2015 meeting. This is a meeting that we have scheduled for tonight, not our typical meeting time, but we're meeting to discuss parcel F and take a vote on parcel F.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, did anybody call Bob Ox?
Well, he knows about the meeting.
I haven't heard he was not gonna be here, so.
Yeah. So,
You heard he was not gonna be?
I have not heard.
Because I talked to him last night and he said he'd be here, but I'm looking at that draft that says 7, but he.
There's confusion on that, right.
Did he perhaps think that it said 7?
So anyways, I sent out emails to everybody notifying them of the 6:30 meeting and there is confusion on the agenda that says 7 o'clock.
Well, this is the draft.
So.
On the screen.
Yeah, so there is confusion there. And I guess what I want to do with that is I want to ask the planning board if they want to wait till 7 o'clock or if they want to continue with the meeting as is. What do you folks feel about that?
It'd be my preference to start. We talked about 6:30 at the last meeting.
Yep. Okay. It's on the town website.
It's on the town website. I don't think we'll have a vote before 7 in the event, so.
I would agree.
I wouldn't vote until possibly around after 7. That would be a delay. I guess there's going to be a PowerPoint.
Well, I don't know. Let's get to that first. I'm not sure there is going to be a PowerPoint, but.
It's noticed as 6:30.
Huh?
It's noticed as 6:30.
Yeah. So I hear 2 for continuing.
I'd just like to find out from the public where they got 6:30 or 7 from and what's out there, what's floating around as far as when this was supposed to start.
I just looked on the website.
On the town hall website?
Mm-hmm.
In the calendar section?
Under your planning board minutes. Agenda.
The agenda button.
Agenda.
Right.
I looked there. But is.
And you saw that?
No, I saw just a blur.
6:30 sentence.
Posting,
yeah, there was a sentence.
Posting,
like
a public hearing posting. Which
said. It said hearing, but then the body.
Said 6:30.
Said
public
meeting.
Yeah.
Since we have cell phones, is there any possible way someone could call him and find out if he's.
Yeah.
Well, we're going to continue on, and if we're not going to be voting before 7 o'clock anyways. So you didn't answer my question. What do you want to do?
I'll abstain. So I'll go with whatever the board decides. I'll abstain from that vote.
Yeah.
Why?
Because
well,
I'm a little conflicted on that.
This is a draft.
I know.
So instead of abstaining, what do you want to do?
I'm abstaining. That's what I want to do.
You dog.
All right.
Why? Am I not allowed to abstain?
No, you can abstain, but it's only to determine. Get a little chutzpah here. All right. No, I'm sorry.
When a gift horse is handed to you, take it.
So we're gonna continue. I think with this meeting at 7 o'clock, and what I want to do is we're gonna hold this meeting to an hour. That's the game. That's the goal. What we're gonna do is the town planner Howard will have an opportunity to give a brief outline of the packet, and then if there's anyone that wants to be talking with regards to the Greenbelt presentation or the Greenbelt issues, then Park and Rec, if there's anyone that wants to talk on behalf of Park and Rec. I'm going to try to keep those individual comments down to for anything being presented with regards to the Greenbelt to 5 minutes, anything Howard no more than 5 minutes on his. Park and Rec, if there's someone from Park and Rec here that's presenting, no more than 5 minutes. Same with Conservation Commission. And then we'll go to the public, and we're going to limit comment there. gonna try to avoid going over what we've already gone over before, and hopefully we can get some new information if there is any, and then we'll bring it back to the planning board for discussion and voting. So with that, before I go to you, Howard, mm-hmm. I just want to begin with Mike Farrell's letter or email. So this is just for the public record. So this was an email from Mike Farrell on Wednesday, July 22nd. And it was sent out to pretty much all parties, Planning Board, Conservation Commission. Subject parcel F, land donation. There are three paragraphs, and the first paragraph identifies that the selectmen are going to be having a meeting. I'm paraphrasing. The selectmen are going to be having a meeting on August 10th to bring the stakeholder boards together to resolve this issue. And then in the second paragraph, he goes on to state the question is about whether it's active or passive recreation purposes. That's the issue at hand. And then his last paragraph says it would be important for the stakeholder boards to take an official vote prior to the BOS meeting on August 10th as to whether the property has a potential long-term use for active recreation and or as a connector to other active recreation lands or be held for passive recreation uses under the care and custody of the Conservation Commission. So that's what we're here for tonight. And you want to stay on top of the August 10th date because in my last verbal communication with Mike, he said the agenda was possibly changing and this particular issue may not be on the selectmen's agenda now for August 10th because something else is coming up with Park and Rec. But tentatively, that's what's scheduled. So with that, Howard?
Provided in the packet was the letter under correspondence, and then I included under new business the recorded decision for the Turning Leaf definitive subdivision. And then I broke it out basically into two sections, exhibit one being information for the board in terms of land being accepted for municipal purposes. And included under that was a color graphic of the one sheet Greenway master plan. And I'll get to that just a minute. Which I have here up on the board. As well as a title description of the active passive recreational greenway project, which was provided to me by Park and Rec. And the number of slides, that's 19 slides. So I believe they're gonna be here to present later in the meeting. Okay. And then provided after that under exhibit two was the section of Mass General Law that has to do with Conservation Commission establishment powers and duties to help the board understand how the Conservation Commission can accept land. I also included in the packet the order of conditions that was written by the Conservation Commission. The findings, the final plan, the conditions defining the terms, and the general conditions of that order of conditions as well. So from this, the board can understand the purpose and intent of the planning board's actions as well as the Conservation Commission's actions. And I understand that the Conservation Commission will be here tonight also.
Okay. Who is anyone here from Conservation Commission? I don't, you guys, you covering them? All right. Park and Rec?
Not yet, a little bit later.
So I think they're still downstairs on the second floor.
Do we know what time they're coming up, or are they just coming up whenever?
No, I think I can go down there 15 minutes and see if they can come up. But they know of the meeting.
Okay. Could we do this, only because they're not here, let's just take a 5-minute recess,
mm-hmm.
and if you go down and check with them and see when they're gonna come back, and also, can you give a, I don't have my cell phone, can you give Bob Watts a?
I did.
Did you?
I texted him twice, nothing yet.
No response?
Yeah.
Okay.
Texted him a couple times.
We're gonna take a 5-minute recess.
I'm gonna take a 5-minute recess, folks.
Motion for a 5-minute recess. Chris?
I think you gotta knock on the door.
Okay, we're back. So we are back in session. I'd like to continue with the meeting for Georgetown Planning Board, August 3rd, 2015. New business planning board discussion on parcel left of the approved Turning Leaf subdivision. So I think if you wanna take a crack at a presentation for it, what I'm trying to do is keep the meeting to an hour, and everybody's taking like no more than 5 minutes.
Okay, I'll go through as fast as I can.
Yeah, and okay. What? Just FYI. So you prepared this and sent it along?
Yes.
Okay. Is it possible to not go through every slide, to skip
yes.
over some of them? Because
sure.
I think there's like three or four that really are what it's all
That's
about.
That's fine.
Okay, so that'd be great.
Mr. Chairman,
yeah.
I think one of the reasons Jimmy and I put this together this way was because this not only shows parcel F in the context of the Greenway
mm-hmm.
and where it is in Georgetown,
mm-hmm.
but it goes a step further and it actually talks about the Greenway and it shows... It traces back, because one of the things that I think has happened is all of the boards concerned have lost the institutional memory of the Greenway, and the first few slides are very important on that part. Very important to know where this all originated. Very important. A lot of the boards have lost that.
I think
it becomes clearer.
But I think the challenge with that, Harry, is that if that's subjective in terms of where the history is and what the history says about the Greenway. So what's going to happen is you're going to be showing what you think is the history of the Greenway, and there's going to be no room to discuss it, no room to present maybe there's another view of what the history of the Greenway was, and it would open up a can of worms for a discussion about a subject where we really have a pretty focused agenda. So I'm leery of going back in time to that great extent. Furthermore, I had no idea this was on the agenda to this degree. It would have been nice to have known. And it's not yet, you can look at him, but it didn't, you know.
Well, it all came
it
out.
Comes in.
7 days,
you know,
last Wednesday.
Yeah, yeah, but still.
Seven
you know,
days before.
Yeah, but there's no discussion. You guys, you know, there's no discussion about this when you send this stuff in. It'd be nice to let the chair know about that stuff. So, I never got it. If you did, I never got it, and I'm pretty good with my emails.
Okay.
So, in any event, so try to.
Sure. So for people.
My head in the way. This isn't the first screen, by the way.
Oh.
No, but I provided this for in the packet. So this is
right.
the overall plan, and so you can see from a higher elevation,
so
this is parcel F.
Yeah, that's parcel F is right here, and just so people get their bearings, the New Life Community Church United Foam is down in here. We have construction now with a new park going on behind that facility. This area here is designated as one developable recreational area. The other one that we've kind of mapped out on the Greenway is over here is flat enough, is right in this area. This is these two parcels we own now, the blue. The reds here are owned by Herrick. These this just so people know, in order to develop an area for recreation use, it has to be flat, it really can't have ledge, can't have a lot of features that would make construction unbearable. This piece was perfectly flat, and there'll be some ball fields, a dog park, and a skate park, and this area here will be soccer fields, potentially could even be a track if the town determines that they can't fit one at the top field at the high school in some future date. We're trying to purchase all these parcels of land to provide a greenway through this section of town, which is the center of Georgetown. And once again, just for your reference, that's parcel left in that parcel. You want to go to the...
How many fields, Jim?
Sure.
What I want to try to do is I want to avoid getting into a conversation about this stuff, if at all possible.
Just if you go by 35 slides, though, there's no room for it.
Well, we're not doing 35 slides. Right. This is.
So, as you know, this is the Georgetown Raleigh State Forest in here. Is that my bearing straight? Mm-hmm. And up here we have the other
Crane
Pond Wildlife Area. We're trying to take this cluster of land in between them as a bridge, a greenway. It's in the center of town. It's also a lot of unlocked land that we're getting. The town was fortunate enough, because of the prices and being landlocked, we're getting about somewhere between $3,500 and $5,000 an acre. Just for your bearing, this is also a power line easement going through.
Can I interrupt you, Jim?
Sure.
Just an important historical note. That last slide was from the 2007 Open Space and Recreation Plan. That's the Concoms,
right.
And those five sections of the Open Space and Recreation Plan in 2007 were incorporated into the master plan from the Planning Board later that year. And the plans are identified in the greenway, though that area was identified in the plan, and it was identified as one of the goals of the action plan in the master plan and the open space plan.
So, just so you're bearing, the idea was to establish this greenway to keep the future development of all these fingers going through each other. Is we able to protect all this land? It is active recreation or passive recreation. We worked with the conservation. They own a couple of these parcels. We own a couple of them. To provide a eventual development of a greenway park like. In Newburyport, they have the fairly nice, extensive park down there. I've now lost my...
Cashman, is it?
Jimmy, you got a couple minutes left.
Yep, so people know how the parcel F is. Parcel F sits in here. It basically borders two halves of the granite. It's a bottleneck in there. We've wanted to provide some access potential for the future of these two parcels, which we have no feeling we're going to do anything with for the near future. It's just we want to work on these two ends first, and that's the middle will be greenway. It'll be an open space area for people to develop in future years. I have no intention to be around for that phase, but that's really the gist of parcel F. It's just in that greenway, and it has some important features that we want to preserve. Yeah, this just shows the proposal that we have a parking area down here that we're building now. There'll be a larger parking area off of Martell Way that will be in these three parcels only. And that will be the extent of our parking area going into these greenways. People have to have to park at the ends and actually, walk through from those points. These are the parcels that we've acquired as of now. Actually, this one has also been acquired. Well, they will be acquired shortly. So we're getting closer and closer. We have this one, and this one is becoming critical to establish a continuous loop through the. Once these two parcels are dealt with, we now have a continuous greenway loop through these parcels. Right. The gist of the greenway. I know a lot of people always question what it is, where it is. There's the two parcels that are important, the Herrick parcels over here. Especially this one right here, this little piece here is important to combine with this parcel here to put in soccer fields. This is basically wetlands, and it's non-usable for park purposes, but it's usable for the greenway, hopefully to bridge this through here. This small parcel is owned by a gentleman in Raleigh, and it has no value, so I would not think that would be difficult to achieve either. And like you said, there's kind of a layout of the wetness of it all. We have some problems right in here getting across this little to get to the Herrick parcel in here. We've handled all the issues down here to get access from this end. But there's some open space there for people to utilize. People want to eventually horseback ride, or I don't know what the laws are going to be for this greenway. We're just trying to establish the actual land mass for a greenway. And there's parcel F, like I said, it sits where it sits. Okay?
Can I ask you a question? Is that okay at this point?
Go ahead.
Can you go back to the first slide with the five different colors? So here we have parcel F in purple,
yep.
Correct?
Yep.
So in the opposite side, you've showed us where there's going to be parking down on this end down here.
Yep.
I've got a pointer, I guess I could use it, in parking up here, right?
Yeah, correct.
So the purpose of the road that is being discussed for parcel F is what?
My feeling on the road would be emergency access. If there's something that's going in the greenway that needs to be done, whether it be fire or ambulance or police, it's also a road that if a municipality like PETA needs to get in there, cut down some trees, I don't know what's going to go in here. If there becomes a sledding area here or horseback riding spot, or this becomes a place where people have a garden, the new garden area becomes. I'm just saying, I have no idea what's going to, but I'm saying if we have it there and has it established, once something is done there, we can do something with it.
What I'm trying to wrap my brain around, though, is the discussion would be a road about basically there, correct?
When you say a road, I'm thinking a fire road, a fire access.
Okay, all right, but where would that?
There's actually a deeded right of way going through there now on the different plot plans.
Okay, but that wouldn't be access necessarily to the fields that are talked about being for here, or the fields that are talked about for here.
No, they're just going up to.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Jimmy.
Okay.
So if we could go to Conservation Commission. You folks, if there was something you wanted to present on behalf of Conservation Commission, if not, we'll just keep moving on.
We can basically to listen. There was no intent.
Could you come up? This is the microphone to catch your name and what you're saying.
My name is Andrew Curry. I'm one of the Conservation Commissioners.
Andrew.
Hi. And I went on the walk with some of the gentlemen here just to look at the land. I hadn't been on the Conservation Commission when this was all approved and so forth, so it was all new to me. So basically my intent on going there was just to find out what the land was like. And what I noted was that the shape of the land is really defined by two tributary streams that are surrounding the developed parcels in that area. So basically what the land is, it's the two tributary streams and the wetlands associated with them, and then kind of steep valley land around it. They're just the side slopes of the valley. So I would look at it, and this is personal because the Conservation Commission hasn't talked about it as a group at this point, but that it could be used for just access, the type of access that it could be just recreation and horseback riding, as you're talking about, or possibly emergency vehicles. The one caution I would have with that, emergency vehicles, is you would be crossing wetlands, and I don't know the specifics of the layout. You know, I haven't really seen a map that shows that, but generally there's wetlands in that whole area. It's just a series of up and down land all through. And so you'd have to look carefully at how that was done. And And to what extent, what type of road you actually go there, whether it's just a bridle path or whether you actually have vehicles going through there. And obviously that all becomes part of the master plan and how you're gonna use the whole green belt. And again, I'm not really fully up to date on the detail of that, but I was really here just to express the fact that it is all lowland, that are the parcels defined by the streams that were there.
Right.
And it's very limited. You gotta work on the side slopes basically, and it's kinda limited in some areas. And the whole area too is also zone A floodplain too, and that whole low area there and directly to the west of it. So that's basically all I wanted to say. So.
Okay, well thank you. That's consistent I think with everybody who's went on the site walk and what people saw.
Okay.
From the board. So thank
okay.
you for
problem.
All right. All right, so I'd like to go to the public now, and I want to just try to limit it, you know, and try not to go over the same thing twice if we don't have to. So if there's some people that want to speak on behalf, great.
Lynn Grossline, 16 Lisa Lane. I have, from one of your meetings, 5/28/14, there was a planning board meeting. And some of the things that were stated in this meeting, I think, are very important. And I'm just going to read it. And it says, Miss Mann, in addition to that, we show a walking gravel path that will access the open space parcel. Mr. Williams says, yes, it's a 4-foot wide parcel, but it's a 20-foot easement. But it's only a 4-foot wide path, gravel path. Then they went on, and it says, is there a handicapped spot? They talked all about this handicapped spot. They said this path is not handicapped accessible path. The route out there is not handicapped accessible. Let me just keep reading. And then it says, Mr. Williams says that when you're talking about the handicapped spots, then he went on to say, and this is the engineer of the development, said it's rough. Once you get into the open space parcel, you have to cross an intermittent stream. It's pretty rugged topography. And then Mr. Letiglia said there's no way it would ever be improved in the future if the town had wanted to. And Ms. Mann said it's a right of way. And then it says, Mr. Williams says, with the current regulations, no, you cannot improve it and build a road across there. You had said, not referring to a road, I'm talking about improvement of a walking path. And Mr. Williams said, no, you can't improve it because of the local zoning wetlands bylaw would not allow it for a road, that is. And Mr. Snyder said the natural terrain goes up and down. Mr. Williams finally said it would be a huge undertaking because of the slopes. And then you said, at least I tried. So that is about whether or not to put a road in there. And it just sounds like from the engineer, it would be a hard thing to do. And it would be a huge overtaking. And I think it'd be a lot of money. And I think we can spend our money somewhere else in our town than going through and building an emergency road to an area that's a greenway that we didn't, is all conceptual. And that's my point.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Jean Nelson, 30 Searle Street. I'm a little bit surprised to see a PowerPoint here tonight. Certainly we as abutters, if we had known we could present PowerPoint, Lynn has fabulous photos of this area. I was told that when you took the walk with Board of Selectmen and some other groups a while ago, you didn't walk on a lot of parcel F. Lynn has pictures of all of parcel F. If we had known we could make a PowerPoint presentation, we certainly would have done so. And Lynn has great photos, and we could have told you all our anecdotal knowledge of this area. Sitting there, all that into the record, I will repeat what I said before. We've talked with the Concom agent, I talked with Howard, I talked with various other people, and they said that this whole parcel F started as mitigation required or requested by the Concom for the subdivision. In my mind, it should have been under the jurisdiction of the Concom. It shouldn't have then been up for grabs for any other use. If this is even designated as emergency access, there's going to be a huge amount of disturbance of the land. There's ledge, there's big outcroppings, as what Lynn just read, there's an intermittent stream. It's not something that is just a flat field where you can put even a gravel access driveway across it. It would mean more blasting, which we've all lived through, some more than others, more cutting, more clearing. That is not leaving a parcel in its natural and undisturbed state, which I truly believe was the original intent of this parcel when it was first addressed by the Concom and the Planning Board. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Okay.
Hi, Nick Feitz on CONCOM. I just have a real short point to make. And when we accepted the turning leaf, this, of course, was given as mitigation. And the importance of this is a wetland, and that's what we're all about. And in that area, I think there's one, maybe two vernal pools, and that's very sensitive to the endangered species, you know, certain salamanders and what have you. And you know, other than a passive use of the land, I think could really be detrimental in that aspect. And I'd hate to see a road going through there, or even an access road. You know, again, we don't have the particulars and what have you. I think that that could be detrimental to the vernal pools. And one of the things that we really want to do is save what we have left. And it's a dwindling pool of what we have. So I think the best custodian at this point would be the Conservation Committee until something more specific and definitive was decided by the town. And anyways, that's just the point I wanted to bring up. And the other thing, and I think maybe they were alluded to last time, is the flooding situation that's happening because of different developments and what have you. And this is sort of like a buffer way, I think. And it's in the floodplain, and there's a reason for it. And I think we want to preserve it as well as we can the way it is. So.
Can I ask a question? Howard, would it be possible? Could you show us, take one of the pointers and show us where those V pools are?
I'm not sure off the top.
I can show you. Do
you know where they are?
Yes, yeah, I'm curious.
I know they're back there.
Maybe we can see the.
I think there's two of them.
Yeah, there's two of them.
There's two of them back there.
The what now? I don't have an overall plan.
No, the.
Go
back to the PowerPoint, the one that.
Go to the PowerPoint with all the.
I've got it. Thank you.
Here's your parcel F. And here's your wetland delineation lines.
But there's a lot more parcel F over here.
Yep. So, but I'm just saying there. I don't know if on there you have any sense of where they fall.
If you go
I think
to the picture where you have
Rob,
the PowerPoint
what,
where all the
you,
waters.
You gotta take. You can manage this.
Right. Funny guy.
He's running the meeting, Howard.
That's okay. I have no problem with that at all. Howard's reminding me. I think to Howard's point, whether or not there are vernal pools there may be. There probably are. There might not be.
There are.
Well. That's what you say, but until I see a map that shows vernal pools mapped, you know, and if they have been mapped, great.
Great. Talk to Concom.
Yeah. So, but I the point is, it's a sensitive land. You know, we get that.
Correct.
We get that.
I only raise the issue because one of the things that might be a solution here that might make everyone happy. Is that it's a very big parcel, and there are, as you say, I'm sure there are vernal pools, and I'm wondering where they are, if they're a distance away from the area that Park and Rec needs, which is actually only a very small section. Park and Rec, and this is a terrible way to show it because it's not showing the other lands that it needs to. Could you show the one that?
All right, I think we're starting to get off track here. Okay.
I think it's the other way, Howard. No, that one's terrible. You can't see anything on that. Keep going. We'll go to the end. Keep going, buddy. Yeah, it's towards the end. It's the one that you said was backwards. No, that's a wetland map.
Yeah.
Okay, then there's parcel F. You can reference that.
There you
that.
Go. Excellent. Good. Can I have a pointer? Would you mind? Are we looking more towards?
That's how I run it.
Top.
Top?
Yeah.
Oh, got it. Yeah. Are we looking more towards this area here, where the V pools are, or are we looking more towards here? Because one of the things that's gone around is a possible A&R, and I think that's a couple slides ahead. That one.
All right, a couple more. We're getting way off track here.
Well, I think it is the track.
I mean, somebody's raised a point though, yeah. And I'm not sure how we can address it if we don't know what people are talking about.
But we can't address it.
Okay.
We can't address it unless we have a map that's been certified for vernal pools. We're just all waving our hands.
Okay.
And I believe when you say there's a vernal pool there, I have no reason not to believe there's a vernal pool there, but I can't go on that.
I understand, right. I didn't really come prepared tonight for that.
Understand.
I apologize for that.
No problem. I don't have it. I would tend to inherently think there would be vernal pools after spending time out on that site. So it didn't surprise me when you said that, but I have to let it go with that. And I think we have to just recognize it as a possible, you know, but that's all.
Okay.
After that.
And I think we're talking a buffer around a vernal pool, wherever it is, mm-hmm. About 100 feet.
At least.
Yeah.
I would hope at least 100.
So.
And so that gets into the specifics, which is the same thing as the code. So.
Okay.
So is there anyone else from the public? George?
George Kaminsky, 45 Old Jacobs Road. You know, what I think is, you know, not just taking a vote on whether this should go to Conservation Commission or town purposes, I think you need to look at the access and send a statement to the selectmen on access, too, because if you can't get access in, I mean, it's almost moot. So when you go back to that slide that shows the 4-foot gravel path, you would be talking, to put into a road, that would probably be considered a major modification of the plan. So it would have to come back to the planning board. Now, when you start talking about emergency access, I know from my own experience on the school building committee, the fire department gets involved, they're going to want a proper road put in. They're not going to want something just throw a bunch of gravel down. You probably going to have to pave it, which Larry Graham states in his minutes, says if it's got 6% slope. And if you look at the topo lines there, there's a drastic drop off. So when you drop off like that, you have to either build up or you have to take off the top. And so probably you would have to build up quite a bit of road that would be paved through a wetland. And what this map doesn't show is the other side of the topography, which is even steeper than that side. So you might be talking like a 15 or 20 foot rise in a wetland, which means you'd have to go through the do not cut, do not disturb zone that the Concom set up as mitigation for this parcel. You're probably talking culverts, you're talking fill, you're talking, you know, contractors say you pay anywhere between 150 and 300 foot, 20 a foot, depending on the slope of the and the terrain of the road. So I would think this would be on the high end or even higher than the 300 foot. So you're talking, you know, I asked Jimmy outside how many fields and where they're going to be located, and from what he says, it's about 1,500 feet. So we're just talking the emergency access. This isn't going to be the main access. So if we're putting in between $500,000 and $700,000 for an emergency access road that we're not going to use, and I think I'm not even counting the drainage, the permitting that would go into this. I mean, so these costs add up, you know. So I mean, if you feel planning board has looked at this, has listened to the abutters, have listened to the engineers, have even listened to the applicant's engineer said that it would not meet, would not get a road out there under our your regulations. That's something you have privy to that the selectmen don't have. For them to, in your call should hold weight on this. So I think not only do you have to address the, you know, whether it should go to CONCOM or whatever other services, you have to address the road.
I agree.
The access to parcel F. That should be the second part of your vote tonight.
Agreed.
So that's just my opinion.
Thank you.
Jack Grossline, 16 Lisa Lane. So hard to have one time period to say anything after spending a year's worth of meetings and only be able to speak once. I don't have a ton of new information other than we had two turtles in our yard for the first time ever, a snapper and a mama laying eggs. There's been a tremendous amount of disruption already with wildlife there already. I know we're not voting on a field tonight, but or that you guys aren't, but I just wanted to say, think a little bit about the 94 signatures on the thing petition. That my wife, the petition, thank you, that was signed. I think we need to be thinking about what should this land be used for, and do we want to put something in place and put a vote on the board tonight that will recommend to the selectmen that might potentially lead to significant development, loss of wetlands, loss of woodland, potential more flooding issues out there. The flood drains that are out in the new development are right now, one of them is full of water. I thought they were supposed to drain out pretty quickly, and we haven't had rain, and I don't know if your lawns are dry, but I don't know how that is full of water right now. But water issues, except potential for major traffic issues, should we encourage the town down a path to use these anything other than the mitigation that, quite frankly, as abutters being here for a year, we're all going to feel, what's the politically correct word, ripped off, quite frankly, should something like that go in. I'm all for fields. I've got kids. I love athletics as well. We need good fields in Georgetown. I'm all for a green belt. I don't want hundreds of cars going by my house and through a development potentially down the road. So my comments.
All right. Anyone else? Okay, seeing no one else, what I'd like to do is bring it back to the board. And what I'm thinking is that each board member can, if they want, you know, take a handful of minutes to ask questions or express their opinion about all of this. And what I'd like to do is, at the conclusion of all of us having an opportunity to speak or ask questions, I have a motion that I would like to put on the table for discussion after that. And so I share that with you now, and we'll let it go with that.
Okay.
All right, so Tilly, you want to start?
Okay.
You don't have to.
Well, I've said already so many things that I don't want to repeat, but I really, when all said and done, I felt like sitting on this subdivision, and it's really the biggest subdivision that I've sat on, and I've learned a lot, and I can understand and feel for the residents. And the residents have been outstanding. They've been very civil. Nobody's been really loud or boisterous or rude. And I got to hand it to all of you for showing up. I listened to a lot of the tapes for the meetings, you know, just to see if I missed something. Because I really felt like I didn't catch that. You know, why didn't I catch that? And so I listened to a lot of it, and I repeated to myself watching this anyway. I felt like, had there been more discussion about this access way, we would have made more decisions, I would have anyway, made a bigger parking area. We didn't. We were thinking of footpaths for access, so we only allowed like 3 to 5 parking spaces for the access. So if there was an access to reach to parcel F and go further to the greenway, you would have expected a lot larger parking lot. We would have planned for that. We would have at least talked about it. East Main Street project has 100 parking lot spaces down there. For just so far, it's just one field and one dog park. And we didn't hit upon that. And I felt like, you know, why didn't we talk about it? I feel like we should have. I know what a greenway is. I was on the original open space plan that we set up a greenway. And my thoughts were, greenways were instituted in not only in Georgetown, but elsewhere because of all the development. The inhabitants needed a place, the deer, the foxes, the turtles, they needed a place because with all this development, we were getting the animals in our backyards. And we wanted to preserve, and that was the basis for Greenway. I think that if I had been informed that ball fields was the goal, I would have done different decisions or different discussions. And I really feel that that's one of the issues. We had two engineers. We had one from the developer, and we had our own consultant. And each one said, this land is undevelopable. If it was worthwhile, the developer would never have given it to us. In a sense, we were doing him a favor taking it because it was getting off the tax rolls. And I didn't think of it as any fields, as even when he was talking about it. I didn't think about ball fields because in my mind, that's developable, you know, and the excess is the key. If I think that if I was in this neighborhood and we had no excess plans at all, there wouldn't be an issue here. There wouldn't be any reason. And quite frankly, at this point, I just as soon modify the plan, get rid of that excess, period. And that's the summation.
Okay. Thank you. Harry?
I'll wait till the rest of it.
I'm just going around.
Oh, okay. It's interesting that you're thinking that way, Tilly. it sounds like, well, if I had my druthers, I drew up something called a possible A&R. We kind of went by it. I think it's the... I think it's the compromise solution. I know the Concom based their decisions and a lot of their waivers for this project on mitigation of having that open space. Personally, I did too. Planning board looks at mitigation issues as well. It's not a free ride. You don't just get a waiver with the planning board because you say please and smile. Well, not anymore anyway. But at any rate, there was some mitigation there, from my perspective. I don't know if it was shared by any of the board members. I would think that the best solution for the town would be to not take this 100% for conservation purposes, because at some point, if you did need to use it and create some kind of an access, whether it be equestrian or otherwise, through that area, you would need a 2/3 vote of the legislature, the House and the Senate. I think the selectmen made a good move at sound meeting by making sure that it stayed municipal, because we can always do whatever we need to do with it, and we can turn it into conservation land, but it's very difficult to take it out of conservation land, as I'm sure you know.
Can I ask you a question about, to clarify something you just said?
Sure.
So this idea of you have to get 2/3 vote from this body, that is to take it out of the hands of Conservation Commission, correct?
Absolutely.
But that's not to say that you can't still have passive paths and passive recreation in there going through Conservation Commission.
Yes.
Okay, I just
absolutely
wanted to clarify that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Can I
in the past, though, Concom, when I was on the Concom never accepted parcels of land that had easements upon them. So I look at it as though the Concom would probably want to have their section of land sectioned off, and Park and Rec would want access through F to 16.6, 16.4, and 16.7. And however that configuration was would work out. I lost the PowerPoint, Howard, you have it, but the A&R that was suggested, it was thrown around by a few people, and it seems to be a solution that is a compromise. Concom gets some, a great deal of the parcel. The water department land, if I may, the water department could have this land here, a 50-foot wide stretch, because the planning board was very insistent upon stubs to loop the water. And stubs are already coming out of here, and I believe they're over here for stubs, so that you can loop the water out at some point. Remember, these are just options to have. They're options. They're not plans. They're not, this is going to happen next week and someone's drawing it up. These are options you're keeping open. And I personally think this is what a planning board's supposed to do. Keep the options open. If there was if this parcel, which the town now holds and which is safe, if this was subdivided through an A&R process, Park and Rec would have the ability to use this area here. They'd be able to approach and access what's called 16-4, 16-6, and 16-7. And I think that would be an equitable solution. This would all be conservation land. This is why I asked where the vernal pools were. I didn't see any when I was walking here. I would suspect they're here.
I think somewhere in that area, number one.
I would suspect.
It's on the Duncan's property.
Okay.
It is near that parcel that you, the blue parcel down there.
It's near here?
Yes.
Yeah, there was something on one of those maps here, 200 feet from vernal pool.
Right, because the vernal pool, that's actually way over here.
Is that the Duncan's property? Is that what she's talking about?
This is further over. This is this parcel, and the parcel we were looking at was right here. This is going to be town-owned land here, town-owned land here, and already town-owned land here. Again, it's very difficult to figure out and sell from the plans. It's rough, but I would recommend, I'd recommend a subdivision of that parcel so that we preserve the town's ability to keep their options open. I think it's an equitable solution. And I really, really think that the worst thing that the Concom could possibly do is shut off all their alternatives to the Martel crossing. But that's just me.
Can I ask a quick question?
This is the only question.
I'm just curious, in what way is it a compromise for the residents that live there and the 94 people that have signed the petition? Just curious.
Okay. I get it. Get your question.
Yeah.
So
may I answer that?
All right.
It's a compromise because what you're dealing with here is, and we see this a lot on the planning board and Concom and boards in general, there are very, very few developments that ever come in that do not in some way affect the townspeople's, the abutters, and the town itself. And one of the things that I've always tried to do, being here on the planning board, is to look to the future and find the least intrusive way to make things happen, minimize the number of abutters that are affected. Remember something here, and I want to show this again. I'm going to grab my little pen. Right here, you have an access way. Where is that? Through 19, between
18.
Here it is. This access way. Remember something. This is a parcel of land that isn't owned by anyone. This is a parcel of land that isn't owned by anyone. This is your access. No one owns these. Anyone that buys them, caveat emptor, they should know when they purchase these parcels that there is an access, there's an easement here. Absolutely, absolutely.
Okay.
But
all right,
you have to look at your alternatives. And your alternatives, you may be forcing something in the future that may be worse.
Okay, time out. I do need, I don't want to get back and forth, okay? He answered your question.
I hope I answered it. I hope I did.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, I hope I answered it. I would recommend an A&R, a subdivision of the land.
Okay.
And then subsequent acceptance of the control of the different areas of that land at town meeting.
Okay.
That would be my suggestion.
Bob, do you have any
just
comments?
Just a few. I think it's a good idea to make sure that there's access by the water department to those stubs. I have come to learn that it's very, very difficult on a site walk to really comprehend what the impact of a proposed change might be. It didn't look to me when we did the walk here on Parcel F like a place where you'd want to put a road of any sort, including under those power lines. This isn't the huge power lines, this isn't a huge power line. This is a relatively small power line. It's a relatively small space. I don't know really where emergency vehicles would be going up there. I don't see any place for ball fields. It looked like a nice place to go for a walk. Really the idea of putting access roads there, it doesn't sit well with me. Now I do have concerns about Martell Way because of the rookery up there, but I know that that's how the blue herons feel about it today. They could move, so maybe that would work better. I really can't say. I live on West Street, so I know what it's like to have a lot of cars going by. And to be candid with you, it is not I-95. It's not 133. I would not be thrilled if they were to triple the size of those, and huge parking lot and change that from my perspective. But from where I walked on Parcel F, and I believe it was really pretty much in this area here, it really didn't strike me as being a good candidate for a road. Thank you.
Just have two or three quick points. I don't know how we vote on something that limits the town's ability to do something forever in the future.
But I don't think that does. So what's your question there?
Well, I think with the conservation, if we turn it over to Conservation Commission, it basically closes that door for all of time.
No. The idea of the water department needing their own piece of land, that is not an accurate portrayal. The water department has worked with Conservation Commission in the past for water lines.
I'm sorry, I mean as far as the road.
Okay.
Would that be an accurate statement, that if it's turned over to Conservation Commission, that road is essentially done for all of time?
I would be, I can't speak for them, but I think the permitting would be damn near impossible.
Yeah. So I'm not sure how I could vote for something that would close off an option for all of time without seeing what the options are. And I'm not sure that we've seen that from Parks and Rec or Conservation or the town, the selectmen or anyone. So I have a very difficult time saying, no, I'm ready to close that off for all of time without seeing what the plans would actually be and who that would benefit.
So even though all of the engineers are explaining to you the ramifications of putting a road in there.
The impact of a road doesn't.
And let me add this.
I don't think that's unimportant. What I'm suggesting is I don't know what we're putting it on a scale. So that's obviously a very important aspect on this side of the scale, but what are we weighing it against? I don't know, because I don't think anyone has come forward and say, this is what our plan is. So I'm not sure what we're weighing it against when we say that the engineers say that this is an important piece. Okay,
okay.
Great. So what are we weighing that against?
Okay.
With Harry's plan, if we hear a plan and say that this is a plan that's not feasible and it's not worth the risk and it's not worth the cost, that parcel can always be turned back over to Conservation Commission. With turning over to Conservation Commission today, that basically shuts that avenue off for all of time. I have a very difficult time with that.
I can confirm question his comment?
Well,
clarify his comment.
Yeah, clarify it, and then if he's through, then I wanted to share my thoughts, and then we'll have some questions.
The Act 97, which was mentioned by Harry, the same restriction is on park and recreation as it is conservation. You have to have 2/3 vote from the legislature on both departments. The only one you don't is municipal.
Right.
Municipal has that option of selling and buying whatever they want.
I couldn't agree more, and which was what the original definitive subdivision approval contemplated. Those are the words that are used, municipal purposes. So don't turn it over to Parks and Rec. Don't turn it over to conservation land. Leave it municipal until a decision is made. And if that decision, and if the right decision is, this is just going to be too costly in environmental terms, it's going to be too costly in economic terms, it's going to be too costly in terms of the abutters, fine. Then at that point, make the decision to turn it over to conservation. But until the full plan is fleshed out and so we can see what we're weighing this against, I have a very difficult time saying, no, that's for all of time. This is going to be given to one particular department.
Okay. Express some of my thoughts. You just identified environmental issues, cost issues, abutter issues. If it was very clear that all three of those take a major hit, is that then enough for you to say we want to take that away? Or is that not even enough and that this is just a philosophical position?
I'm just not sure what we weigh that against. Against turning and saying that, well, we're never going to do a greenway ever? Well, then maybe that's
a highway. Have a big highway up there.
Wait.
I mean, it's an option.
No,
it could happen. It could. I mean, it's some.
But let me wait. So as far as greenway.
I think that was unnecessarily.
Okay, time out. I want to finish the questions.
If we should stop acquiring.
Time out. I'm now starting to get a little miffed. Please, I want to finish this conversation, these questions. So what to measure it? You want to take a break, Harry?
I could go pee.
I've been drinking a lot of water.
Because I'm just trying to understand, when you talk about not, and I don't want to try to get into a, I'm not trying to get into a conversation with you about trying to convince you of anything. I'm just trying to understand, okay?
Sure.
Matt? So when you say the environmental issues, the cost of something like this, the original understanding handshake with the Turning Leaf subdivision people, that because you don't know what you're measuring it against, all the possibles, that even if those three are to show you that one of the possibles, a very reasonable possible, that's what is being actually talked about, would hammer all three of those criteria, that's still, you're not comfortable with Conservation Commission.
I guess I would
taking
just
that option away.
I guess I would just really feel a lot more comfortable hearing from the people that are putting this forward, Parks and Rec, for example, why they need this road, what the alternatives are to this road, what it forever forecloses if we say that they can never build this road. If it means that there can never be a greenway, for example, well, that's something that weighs very heavily on this side. If it's just, boy, you know, we'd really like to do that, it would be a little bit more convenient, well, that's obviously a very different scenario. And that makes it a lot easier to weigh, put the two things in the scale and see which one is more definitive. I'm saying one way leaves it open for the future, one way forecloses it forever, and until we've given people an opportunity to come forward and say, this is what we're truly proposing, and this is what, you know, boots on the ground, this is what we're looking for, I think it's a difficult thing to foreclose for all of the time.
I understand. Thanks for bearing with me in answering my questions. I think for myself, where I am with this is that my first point is that there's no question that this was approved as mitigation for the Turning Leaf subdivision. I hold that up as number one, that there was clearly an implied understanding with the Turning Leaf subdivision that this land was going to be mitigation. And mitigation means addressing issues such as wetlands, existing woods to remain, water quality, floodplain, vernal pools, all of those issues that are, you've already given the developer, you know, a ticket in exchange for protecting these. And that sort of gentleman's handshake sort of means a lot to me. And so at that very basic level, you know, if this is not fully mitigation, then anything else is inconsistent with how the project was approved.
Can I ask a question on that, though?
Please.
If that was the case, but for two words, we wouldn't be having this discussion. Recommended for the Town of Georgetown Board of Selectmen to accept the applicant's gift for Conservation Commission's purposes. But it doesn't say that. It says for municipal purposes.
Correct. So and I'm of the opinion, this is my own personal opinion, Matt. I'm of the opinion that got slipped in there pretty cleverly at the end.
Okay.
That's just my take, because I think Tilly has actually been snap on, where in this whole discussion way back when the first vote came, and I wish to hell I had been part of this subdivision approval process, but Tilly abstained from the original vote because she, if I'm not mistaken, was listening to Conservation Commission's concerns right from the get-go, and she tried to express them when everyone was voting to approve the order of conditions.
The order of conditions?
The final decision.
The decision of approval.
Our decision.
Yeah, the decision, right. I think the history of the project has just been really clear, and that's how I think those words got. That's what I think about those words. But you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. Those words threw a big monkey wrench in there, very cleverly so. I also think the second part of this for me, and I don't think the attorney's letter trumps that this is mitigation and that was the handshake that was made. The attorney's letter, it wasn't a letter, it was an email from John Eichmann, Thursday, March 26th, to Mike Farrell. I don't know if you remember reading this guy or not, but it was part of a packet and we talked about it briefly, but there's a whole lot in it and you would understand it better than I. But in his last paragraph, he goes...
Can I ask what the question was that it is a response to? Because that's very important when you get an opinion.
Yeah.
You know what the question is.
Yeah, well, that was underlined and that was going to be the next thing I was going to talk about.
Maybe we should start there.
What?
So that we know what the
response
is.
Rob, why don't you take it? Harry, let him...
Do you want to do it?
I'd like to know what the question is for the response. I don't remember it.
So this is a March 26, 2015 email from John Eichmann, Town Council, and Mike Farrell had sent him a request for some clarification. And in the last paragraph is really the sum of what John Eichmann, his response is. And what Mike Farrell has asked is, the Conservation Commission has threatened to revoke their approval for the subdivision if the donated property is used for active recreation. Can they do that? This is a 26-home subdivision. So that was the question that was asked of Town Council. And what Town Council says in the end is, I wish you guys wouldn't write like this. I love you guys, don't get me wrong. In sum, my opinion, neither the Conservation Commission nor the Planning Board has a right to insist that Parcel F be conveyed to the town for any purpose. The Conservation Commission may, however, have the right to insist that maintenance of Parcel F as open space is a condition of the order of conditions it issued for the subdivision, although they must be prepared to prove this by reference to good evidence in the record. And now this is me talking. I'm assuming that's meeting minutes and the video and the tapes and things
like
that. No, not the decision, because he's just, that's in, this is in response to, they must have good evidence to show that they did talk about this, and the reason this whole question has come up is because they didn't specifically say.
They didn't say it in the condition.
Correct, correct.
Yeah.
I have not reviewed any, the last one sort of gets us off the track again, but when I read this, and then I've had conversations, and I wish the chair was here tonight. I wish Steve Brzezinski was here tonight. This is an important issue. I'm kind of disappointed. But that being said, you know, in my conversations with them to try to understand this, correct me if you have a different opinion or you don't know. You had discussions of this in your meetings, and it's in your meeting minutes where this notion of Parcel F and what it was to be used for was talked about as to be under the care and custody of Conservation Commission.
That's my understanding, exactly.
So, and that's what I've heard from Steve Brzezinski, that's what I've heard from, and now this is just words, and I don't have anything in paper, which in the end is all that matters, which I've been asking for forever from you guys. So then I read the attorneys and I go, okay, there's another example of, this has already been done, talked about and decided. It really has, and there's this little thing that got snuck in, these two words at the end, it's this. So, and then the third thing, I'm a designer of roads. You know, I do it. It's part of my profession. And, you know, the $250, $300 lineal foot per cost for ledge, for steep slopes, for wetlands, for wetland crossings, for bridges, absolutely right on the money. Now, I don't know how many lineal feet there are to this road, but, you know, you're talking $150,000, $200,000 worth of construction, I'm sure, easily for just the road, let alone the bridge. The bridge is probably $50,000, $100,000 to get a bridge crossing that's going to meet Conservation Commission's requirements. The cost to the town, if we go ahead with this, all the possibles, and this is a classic thing that happens in this town, the elements are not fleshed out, the town keeps making these decisions that boxes them into these corners, and next thing you know, what comes before the town is a new wall that has to go up in front of a church, another $60,000 worth, a new, you know, these costs, the town doesn't have this money.
But respectfully, Rob, we're not voting to spend the money either. We're voting to leave it open that it could be spent if that was the best alternative.
That's correct. We are not voting to spend the money. That is correct.
And what and you at a town meeting or wherever, when they say this is what we want to spend the money on, it would be a great objection that that's a terrible use of the money. But then, I'm not sure that that's the purpose of tonight's meeting, because all we're saying tonight is, yes, this is somewhat is feasible sometime in the future, or it's not.
So, and then the last part that I would talk to would be that this reminds me a little bit of the high school, the new Pembroke. And the idea that the planning board was not qualified to sit on that and review that project because of a procedural mechanism, because of a committee that did not want to hear what the planning board said, even though that was the charge of the planning board. And what's, you've got a Conservation Commission, which I have a great deal of faith in. I know they're not perfect. I know sure as hell we're not perfect. The town has a great planning board that has a job to do and a charge to do. I have faith in these two boards to let them do what they're supposed to do. The Conservation Commission has said what needs to happen, and I know where I feel needs to happen on this issue. So, you know, with that, what I would like to do is I would like to make a motion, put it on the table, and then we can have discussion about it and vote no or vote yay. So with that, and the reason I'm doing this, I typically would not do this, but I think it's a tricky motion and I think it's important. So I took some time. I'm sorry.
Just to clarify, when you say it's impossible against conservation land, that under Article 97 something couldn't be done. Tilly was right to point out it's also parkland, but the impossibility that is something that's being debated by environmental groups. They're saying it's too easy. You know, if I went online tonight to look up Article 97 conversions. Most of it involves parkland. And you need, it's the same thing, you need the unanimous vote of the park commission. But also, it has to go under what's called a state NEPA review. And the state says you gotta look at alternatives and you have to provide land of equal or greater value. So what developers do, there's one in Lowe's in Quincy where they wanted about an acre of parkland. They said, we'll give you 2 acres down the other end. So that was enticing to the town, so they could get a private development, and, you know, and they got 2 acres of parkland, but it had to go through this review, and legislature has been found, they go usually 98% of the time in approving it. So to say that it's impossible now that it's conservation land, well, it isn't true, and it's not true for park and rec either. So I think that's a misconception. If you're hung up on this will never happen, I mean, the probability that I try to point out, it's probably not going to happen because of all the costs that were brought up and all that. But, you know, if it's park or conservation, there is the possibility. It's not just municipal services it has to stay in.
Okay, thanks, George.
You know,
that's fine. I want to try to allow the people who have bought into Turning Leaf to get on with their lives and not leave this thing hanging. So with that, you know, how my motion would read would be the following. I motion upon review of new, and I have a copy, Howard, which I can give you.
Yeah.
I motion upon review of new and additional information that became known to the Planning Board after Planning Board's affirmative vote on definitive subdivision decision of approval, which recommended Parcel F be accepted by Board of Selectmen for municipal purposes. Planning Board is of the opinion Parcel F consists of substantial and challenging natural resource areas that should be in care and custody of Town's Conservation Commission, including easement rights to allow non-vehicular access except for emergency response equipment that does not require road construction for purpose of passive connectivity of municipal lands. And what that's trying to do is it's trying to allow for the connectivity to exist. It's trying to hold to the original order of conditions, and it's trying to define that you cannot come in with an emergency access road. It might be as soon as you get into the construction of a road, you get into the sections, you get into the 12 inches down, you get into the width, the drainage. If you can find a contour for a four-wheel all-terrain vehicle to follow, and you have grass growing up between the wheels, and that's emergency access, great. It allows for that connectivity. It also allows for people to walk in pedestrian passive access consistent with Conservation Commission with the intent of what the Turning Leaf subdivision was. It doesn't change that, take that away. It's just saying no active development, no road construction.
Is there a second on the motion for discussion?
He can't make the motion.
You need to move the motion then?
Yeah, right. So moved.
Is there a second for discussion?
Second.
Could I read that one, please? Okay.
Do you have another copy, Robert?
I do, and I wish to heck I had made more. I'm sorry. I can read it again for the public, too, if you want.
Yeah, thank you.
I will read it again.
So just to clarify, this is a motion in response to the town administrator's request. It is not a modification of the recorded decision of approval for the subdivision.
Correct. Thank you. Which they asked us to do.
And for discussion, the municipal purposes that's listed can only be electric, water. What else? I think that's it. They can't, municipal purposes is not a park. It's not riding horses. It's not passive or active recreation. By state law, municipal purposes means just that. Electric, your water, and I'm sure there's a couple of others.
Mass General Law states that the words municipal purpose as used in this section shall include any such land, easement, or right therein within the city or town, so purchased or taken by eminent domain for the purpose of conveying or granting the same to the Commonwealth for the use of a regional community college. For any municipal purpose for which the purchase of taking of land, easement, or right therein is not otherwise authorized or directed by statute, but no land, easement, or right therein shall be taken or purchased under this section unless the taking or purchase thereof has previously been authorized by the council or vote of the town, nor until an appropriation of money to be raised by loan or otherwise. No land shall be purchased for any municipal person city subject to this section for any price more than 25%. So it doesn't get into specifics about electric or water.
The reason that's written there, though, as I read it, is because they wanted to include the community college. But municipal did not include that as one of the purposes for municipal uses. So that's why they put that in there. It does not define municipal purposes.
So is this motion going to define this planning board's intention in using the word municipal purposes?
I think in response to that question, I think what I'm trying to do, Tilly, is to get this into the hands of the Conservation Commission and then let the process play out in terms of whatever is decided for so-called municipal purposes later. It still has to go through the Conservation Commission, regardless of what that municipal purpose determines to be. And my concern, if we try to start defining this now, it's going to unravel.
Okay.
But that's just me. I'll read this again for you all. Motion upon review of new and additional information that became known to the planning board after the planning board's affirmative vote on the definitive subdivision approved, which recommended parcel F being accepted by the Board of Selectmen for municipal purposes. Did that make sense there, that part? Planning board is of the opinion parcel F consists of substantial and challenging natural resource areas that should be in care and custody of town's Conservation Commission, including easement rights to allow non-vehicular access except for emergency response equipment that does not require road construction, the purpose of passive connectivity of municipal lands, which now I'm just talking, seems to be consistent with what was approved on the plans where you have the four parking spaces and you have this easement going through. And in any scenario, if there was ever an emergency, it would be great to be able to get a four-wheeler in there if someone had a heart attack or something like that. But it's not road construction and it's not disturbance to the land. Just wanted to wait if you want to call the voter. I want to keep talking about it. Jimmy, please, your park and rec.
No. Yeah, this is.
Oh,
this
I'm
is
sorry.
The word.
No,
that's fine.
I can't. Sorry. Harry, I'm sort of, I'm not pressuring you, I'm just waiting on you. If you're ready to vote, we'll vote, but if not...
Oh, good, call it. I'm just looking at it, require road construction for the purpose of passive connectivity.
Okay, so the vote's been called. Seeing no more discussion. All in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed?
Nay.
There you have it, 3-4, 2 against. Thanks, everybody, really. Thanks for all of your work. Harry, thank you very much, seriously. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Okay, this meeting, I think we can adjourn.
We wanted, we're not gonna discuss the wall or something? Was it, or was it not time sensitive?
We weren't,
I know you're busy, but there's nothing we should do on that.
Is Mantor gonna whack us with another $10,000 if we don't do it this week?
He's just, but he's sitting on this project now, because we feel that wall gets determined. We had a Park and Rec vote to do the wall.
I will stay if the board votes to stay to talk about this, we can.
Can we limit it to 15 minutes?
15 minutes, Jim?
Yes, if something you feel you can't be resolved.
Well, first of all, the board needs to decide what's in the scope of this conversation, because you're not gonna be able to vote on anything, right?
Why?
What are you gonna vote on?
Whatever the motion is.
Do we need a public hearing?
No.
So?
No, do you need a public hearing?
I don't know what the motion is, not if it's insignificant.
So I guess the question is, it might not be insignificant.
So do you consider the park at the top of the hill?
Why don't you present what it is first, and then we'll...
This is a, so we have a plan here for a retaining wall along the right side. And it's basically because we could have done two things. We could have put a retaining wall, we could have gone to grade. The church is really upset about us going back to grade. I feel there's a number of safety issues doing that. And the Park and Rec also knows they can keep the width of the street a little bit wider, which would be beneficial to people passing. And the church has taken a setback on their, on this, as far as we've been up there. So there's a safety factor as far as having the wall being better. It makes the road from 18 feet to about 19 feet in all the whole length. It's a hit on the Park and Rec, but the Park and Rec felt, the park's gonna be there for 100 years. If we don't do it now, we're gonna do it 5 years from now. He's cleared the land, he's sitting on this hill now that's clear, hot, I guess. No one way or the other, the church is pretty adamant that their feeling is that we can't, in order to meet grade, we'd have to go back on their property, and they're not going to let us. They originally, I think in 2008, we had signed some agreements with them to, well, we grade the property. They're not in a situation now that they feel bringing the grade back so far into their parking lot is gonna be beneficial. This is not the parking lot, we're talking about the water flow. This is towards the front of the property.
I think I understand what I'm hearing you say, but I need to see something.
So this is an under 4-foot retaining wall going up the right side.
Yep. So what it...
The question that I would have, while he's looking at that, is, that was a big issue with Lou as well as Gail and Larry Graham, the calculations for the drainage. Now, have you kept in line with the plan? Do we need a change in that?
No.
Does your drainage gonna change?
Drain's still going back to this drainage still predominantly, no, it's all going back. This is not the parking lot shift where all the water's going back into the trench on the back. This is just the grassy hill area. Would have to go back into the, if you look at the front of the church, there's some parkings, there's some tar in the front of the church that wasn't even looked at when we talked about tar. They'd have to grade back, and they're getting back into the tar in the front of the church, not the side. Remember, we talked about the side of sloping it down and getting, we still have that trench going down the back. So there's just mainly, when we cut into the hill to put, there was a question of, when we cut in the hill, we had to put power. We couldn't put power underneath the road. We couldn't put power in the no-cut zone. So the only way to do it is to go into the space we had to the right of where the road was gonna go. So we cut in, we put the two Schedule 80 pipes, 4-inch, underneath
So why, and why did those pipes?
Electricity.
No, I guess my question is, why were those pipes not coordinated on the drawings? Like, what's generated this change? Is it just something that the church would like because it makes it better for them? What's the town?
Oh, so became a situation where we cut in the hill. The road's 18, supposed to be 18 feet all the way down. There are some places it's even less.
Yep.
It's basically based on the surveying. If you look at the original plan, if he was to go down to full grade and leave that grade, we're supposed to have an 18-foot wide road according to the survey and the plan.
In the end when it's paved, right?
In the end when it's paved. And it wasn't there. That 18 feet wasn't there.
So the plans were incorrect?
Plans, I think, were off by maybe a half a foot to a foot on that side.
Really?
So he could have maybe graded it a little bit more to bring it back another foot. And it just, yeah, it'd be so. The question is, when he cut into that hill now to put in the power, it's now we got the hill cut, and the church didn't like the narrowness of that road with all the people passing. They felt it was better to have the retaining wall to go to a full 19 plus on that road. That extra.
What does Gail say about these changes? Are they?
Gail's okay. So Gail's like, yeah, it's better, but it's gonna cost money. It's better, but wasn't this discussion? Remember, our original discussions was to get the project into a scope that we could bid it and get it on into a budget with which we had money. So they were saying, yeah, it's a better, you know, they originally recommended we put a retaining wall, but we kind of said, look, we don't have the money for a retaining wall. It was something we always wanted to do because it made the road wider and made it plowing and just a better access point. Especially, you know, if you got to remember, we talked about the sidewalk, the hill, you know, there was a lot of back and forth about different concepts.
Yeah.
So there's still the opinion that it's better, but it's going to cost. It's an expensive wall.
Wasn't there always a wall there of some sort?
There was originally a plan for a wall, just a small section at the top,
right,
where they couldn't grade back because it was going to affect the
parking.
And it was still is an issue. Now it becomes going with that. It's all under 4 feet. It's like 46 inches or less. There's a number of steps.
I guess where I'm going with that, Jimmy, is that I'm just trying to
get
a sense of who's responsible to pay this, and I don't always want it to just be the town that picks up the dime, and I'm not clear on you know, the drawings and mm-hmm. their accuracy or are these just change orders being driven by a wish list, because then it is on the town's dime. But I'm not clear yet on that.
We probably opened up the can of worms when we put in the power and ripped into the side of the hill.
And why did that go there? Was it always supposed to go there?
According to the code, you can't go underneath the street or you can't go underneath the sidewalk. So we had
where did the plans show it being proposed for originally?
I don't know that. I don't know if it showed it exactly. I believe it did, but I didn't look at that page.
Okay,
I don't think the location of the pipes was shown, just the section detail of what the conduit would be.
So they never showed where they were going?
I don't think they ever showed where the pipes
really?
Were going. I don't think there is any diagrammatic.
The utility?
Wow.
The utilities plan?
Right, I think you're right. I think they showed that.
There is a utilities plan, but I don't think they showed the power conduit.
Was it a line running along that?
I think they did, honestly, but I could be mistaken, you guys are more familiar with it. But to me, I think we need a statement from Gail that this was not on the plan, and why, if it was better, why didn't he recommend that to you people?
They did recommend it to us, but it was a cost prohibitive factor. Remember, we had, phase one money, and phase 1A money was put in there with the continuation of phase one in the completion of a skate park. So it was money put in on the phase 1A town article, the way it was worded, to finish phase one and the completion of a skate park as far as phase 1A. So we had we had some money because the bid was lower than the money we had in the till, and we have some money from phase 1A. So we have the money to do it, and the question is, do we want to spend that money on this feature?
Yeah.
and it became, we always kind of had in our back mind, we wanted something. Believe me, I didn't expect it to be 200 feet. I thought we'd get around with 100 and have them grade the hill, but there's a number, actually we cut about 50 feet, so when you pull in.
Because of those lines.
Well, if you pull in, you also have a place to push snow, and if someone actually slid, you wouldn't want them hit the side of a concrete. So we actually, if it looks, it's 50 feet up is where it starts. So, and that's actually, in some respects, it saves us a little bit on the wall, but it's become a number of factors. One, that we kind of wanted, we couldn't afford it. Number two, the church has seen the hill cut, and they think it's beneficial to them as a church to be, you know, it's a nicer looking, and it's safer for them. We've torn up their area, that area somewhat. They also don't want us to grade back into their land anymore. They felt that they made a number of concessions with the parking grading.
Isn't there
and stuff.
A temporary construction?
Yeah, there's a construction.
We have
one.
Oh, okay. So they really don't. Yeah. Okay. They prefer it.
They prefer it.
Right, but they can't prohibit it.
No.
Okay.
Why do we have to vote tonight? Do you need a vote tonight? Can we vote tonight?
I mean,
because I'm just.
No, I think I think
I'm trying to.
I think it's going to delay, but it's not going to stop. If you can tell me what you need. I mean, it was supposed to be done on the 6th. As far as the scheduling and stuff, it's supposed to be worked at and looked at. If we can get to a point that we can make a decision, I don't know what it's going to mean for him.
I think the only decision the planning board can make is this is a minor or major modification of the decision in the approved plans.
Right. How do just without taking a vote and stuff? Do you guys feel that you're talking $60,000?
About 52.
It doesn't sound like money.
No, it's 52.
Well, it's there is a cost, but as Tilly brought up, how does this change the stormwater? Does this modify any of the stormwater?
Yep, all that. That's part of it.
It'd be nice to have a letter that states that this is the change that's required, and this is the impact of the change.
Can I suppose if Gail were to issue a supplemental sketch showing these changes in plan view,
okay,
where they identify, you know, what
they were going to do that anyhow.
Were they going? They probably would. I mean,
last time you were here, you talked about them issuing a
sketch. Right. Well, they were. The question they had was, they going to go with the stamp drawing from Shea Concrete, or were we going to go with a drawing?
I want the responsibility to remain with Gail,
okay,
because they really are the ones that, I mean, the stamping of the structural integrity of the wall is fine for Summit. They can do that, but the layout materials grading, that needs to be Gail's responsibility.
Okay.
Does the church have any more issues that you're aware of about this?
Well, there's the only other thing is going down. They still have an issue with the fence or the gate. About where we're going to, the location of that. They also have an issue with lighting down, at least down to the entrance of that gate.
We're going to deal with that on the next meeting, though, right?
Yeah, it's on the agenda for the 12th.
So it's a question of whether or not this is.
Collectively.
Yeah, let's get it together.
Okay. Everything
so,
together.
So there are three issues then at the next meeting that would be talking about this, and mm-hmm. what you'd bring to this to that meeting would
sure.
be that supplemental sketch yes. from Gail.
Are you going to bring Gail?
Sure, if you'd like.
That might be a good idea.
Should I make a motion that this be considered an insignificant change so that it can go to a public meeting and not a hearing?
I'm not prepared to do that yet.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
To hold a hearing.
I mean, I don't know if it is an insignificant change, I guess.
Yeah,
because we haven't heard
what constitutes an insignificant change. Is
it
strictly financial?
Of this
there was
no,
a vegetation
no,
plan
I,
there, wasn't it? On this?
Not on that side.
I think
no.
Howard, at some point, you can be adding so many small elements
mm-hmm.
that they add up individually themselves. They're insignificant, but they start adding up, and then when you see where you started to where you are now, and you're talking about lighting, new lighting, right? You're talking about a possible gate being relocated.
Mm-hmm.
The light we're talking about is solar just to the entrance of that gate.
Yep. So and those, this is just me. My gut tells me those are insignificant. But this one sounds a little bit more, and because I don't have a plan graphic
mm-hmm.
in front of me, so I don't know.
Procedurally, into our bylaws,
we just said no. That
modifications to approved site plans. In the event a modification is made to an approved site plan, the applicant shall submit 10 copies, so forth. Modified site plans will, in most instances, be subject to the same review and hearing procedures as was the original. However, for small and insignificant modifications, the planning board may determine that a particular modification does not warrant an additional public hearing. Such a determination shall be made only after written request and 10 copies of the plan showing the modification have been submitted to and reviewed by the planning board. A determination that a modification will not require a public hearing shall be made by the planning board within 21 days of receipt of the written request and plans, and only after the planning board has found that the proposed modification is not significant and is consistent with the previously approved site plan.
So we can't determine if it's insignificant until we get that sketch, that supplemental sketch, 10 copies of it, or you don't get 10 copies. But is that right, Howard? We can't determine if it's insignificant until
we're going to need that, we're going to need the lights, we're going to need the gate, we're going to need it all.
Yeah.
Paper.
In a written request stating that you request the modification.
Well, for yourself, I always had in my mind that insignificant meant that Howard could make an approval, go forward or
not. No. Insignificant.
That's how I always looked at it.
We do not have to post a hearing for a modification in the paper and go through the hearing process all over again.
I
it means we can do it at a meeting, like we are now.
I think we have the option if mm-hmm. we wanted to. We could authorize Howard to just address it on his own, and his decision would be final. And that could also, and that would be only under an insignificant change that we could authorize him mm-hmm. to do that. But Harry's right.
Well,
so get everything together.
Cool. And you want to try to, I know it's last minute stuff, but you want to get it to us not the night of the meeting.
Yeah, I know. Okay.
When do your packets go out?
Thursday. End of the day Thursday.
So, you know.
You've already provided me with a sketch for the wall.
Well, that is the stamp. I think we want to put it on a plan that Gail takes ownership of.
I guess, yeah, but I guess, too, when I look at this plan, Howard, I'm just not clear on what was once proposed and what has changed.
Oh, agreed. Okay. Yeah.
And that's what Gail.
And it also can show the gate and the lighting.
Yeah.
Because the planning board's going to have to vote on something to determine if it's minor or major.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good luck.
Yeah. Got my direction.
When did the change order request come to the Park and Rec?
Change order request.
Manager.
About 2 weeks ago, I think. We discussed it. We talked about all sorts of options. Someone wanted to put road barrier, concrete barriers down there. I mean. Because yeah, this is an expensive wall. What is the necessary? You know, what are our alternatives? You know, this was a wall that seemed to be the most cost effective for 200 feet.
Jersey barriers would be cheaper, huh?
Yeah. And so we had some members who wanted that. We got a letter from the church saying that they would not accept a Jersey barrier on their face of their church, because that was, you know, it is a church, so.
They
brought us in as they put a pocket there, not hoping to, not to decrease their values of their church that much by the things that we do, which is a reasonable. I mean, we bought land, but we also weren't, you know, we're trying to be a good neighbors to some respect.
I think a 4-week turnaround on a change order is reasonable, right?
All right.
Thanks, Chairman.
Thank you. Motion to adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
Hi. Thanks, everybody. Oh. Harry, thanks, Bobby.
For just a good meeting.